Good morning, or good afternoon, or good evening, depending upon what time you tune in to our midweek study for the next 6 weeks. My name is Ted Land. I'm the transitional pastor at Palmasola Presbyterian Church in Bradenton, Florida, also serving as moderator of the congregation in session of Westminster Presbyterian Church in Bradenton, which is nesting with Palmasola at this time. I have a cold, or maybe allergies, or maybe both. I do not have the coronavirus. That's the good news. The bad news is I've got a cold, a sore throat, a cough, a runny nose, allergies, oak pollen, and other things. I'm going to try to do the best I can to muddle through the beginning of our study. Before I do, I want to have a prayer, and in this prayer, I want to remember some special people. Lee Martin and my brother Richard, who both will be having surgery tomorrow. Lee here in Bradenton for a back crack vertebra. My brother Richard in Nashville, Tennessee, having a reverse total shoulder replacement, whatever that is. Nancy Schmandl just had a similar procedure done and seems to be recuperating well, but let's keep her in our prayers. Linda Progar has had 2 bouts in Blake Hospital ICU, and God love her, she tuned into the congregational meeting voting on the sale of property at Westminster Sunday. And by the way, that passed unanimously. Let's pray. Lord, you've been our dwelling place in all generations, from everlasting to everlasting, you are our God. Continue to bless us in these pandemic times, in pandemonium. Bless us, keep us, guide us, direct us, protect us, and use us to your glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Before I begin our study, I'm going to make an announcement. This coming Sunday, I'm not going to try to record a service and a sermon. We're going to have instead a service that was recorded for Sunday, July 5th. By one of the moderators at General Assembly, the Reverend Dr. Cindy Coleman. I hope you will enjoy the service. It will be different. And I hope by the next Sunday, I'll be back in harness and in full voice and with full wind. Our study for the next 6 weeks is the great ends of the church. Someone asked me, where do I find that in the Bible? And the answer is you don't. You find it in the Constitution of the Presbyterian Church USA. Our Constitution is 2 books. The Book of Confessions and the Book of Order. And the Book of Order begins with a section that nobody ever reads unless they're preparing for the standard ordination exams to the Ministry of Word and Sacrament. It begins with the foundations of Presbyterian polity. Now, polity is an old-fashioned word that we use. It means government. But since we use the word government in several other places, we came up with an old word, polity. It's not the same as politics, because there's politics and then there's polity. There's politics in government. There ought not to be any politics in polity. The great ends of the church are found in that beginning section, the foundations of Presbyterian polity, which is begins in chapter 1. And the title of chapter 1 in this is The Mission of the Church. And about halfway through this first chapter, one finds the great ends of the church. And the great ends of the church are the proclamation of the gospel for the salvation of humankind, the shelter, nurture, and spiritual fellowship of the children of God, the maintenance of divine worship, the preservation of the truth, the promotion of social righteousness, and the exhibition of the kingdom of heaven to the world. This statement of the great ends of the church came from the United Presbyterian Church of North America. Now, the United Presbyterian Church of North America were the old Scots Covenanters and Seceders. And they mainly were in Pennsylvania, Western Pennsylvania, and Ohio. The heartland still of American Presbyterianism was that old United Presbyterian Church of North America. And they were actually founded in 1858 in Pittsburgh. My dear friend, late dear friend and mentor, and the pastor who married us, stated clerk of three presbyteries in his career, who died last year in his 90s, the Reverend Robert Christie Morgan, was ordained in 1958 in the United Presbyterian Church of North America in the Presbytery of Pittsburgh, where it was founded. Christie always took great pride in the fact that he was ordained in the last year that that denomination was in existence, and it was particularly poignant for him. Christie had grown up in the Southern Presbyterian Church and had been born and raised in Alabama, except for his first position in Pittsburgh as an associate pastor. All the rest of his service was in the South, in the deep South, some of it in Mississippi, where he and I served together in St. Andrew Presbytery. That Covenanters and Seceders group really came out of the old Associate Reformed Presbyterian Church, which still exists in two or three different forms, mainly in South Carolina. And they adopted the great ends of the church as part of their constitution. This statement was adopted by the old United Presbyterian Church of North America in 1910, following various actions between 1904 and 1910, looking forward to a revision of the church constitution. One of the things about Presbyterians is we're confessional. We have a book of confessions. Another is that we're connectional. We're related through presbytery, synods, general assemblies, denominations. And we're also a constitutional. Each one of us, each different Presbyterian body has its own constitution. When in 1958, the centennial year, the year that Christie Morgan was ordained to the gospel ministry, the United Presbyterian Church of North America merged with the Presbyterian Church in the United States of America. And that was the oldest and largest Presbyterian denomination. It's the one that had its first General Assembly back in the 1700s, and John Witherspoon was the convener of that. And if that name doesn't mean anything to you, then John Witherspoon's signature is on the Declaration of Independence. He was a Presbyterian minister and the only one to solemnly minister of the gospel to sign the Declaration of Independence. That merger brought together two streams. Kind of appropriate, I guess, that the old United Presbyterian Church of North America was in Pittsburgh, because if you've ever been to Pittsburgh, Three Rivers Stadium used to be where all the pro football, and I guess baseball too, took place in Pittsburgh. Two rivers come together and form the mighty Ohio River there. I believe it's the Allegheny and the Monongahela that come together and form the mighty Ohio River. Three streams of Presbyterianism existed in 1958. You had the wonderful old Covenanters, the Scottish Presbyterians of Pennsylvania and Ohio. The Covenanters and Seceders. And then you had those mainline Presbyterians from Philadelphia, and New York, and New Jersey, and Princeton. And then you had the rebels. You had the ones who had seceded in 1861 and formed what for a brief time was known as Presbyterian Church in the Confederate States. And that denomination, after the Civil War, after the Confederacy ceased to exist, became the Presbyterian Church, U.S. Not USA, but U.S. It went from being PCCS to PCUS. And that's the denomination in which I was raised, ordained. That's the denomination that founded Palmasola Presbyterian Church. Interestingly enough, Westminster's lineage goes back to the Northern Stream. But those three streams came together. The first two in 1958. And then in 1983, in a meeting in Atlanta, Georgia, that which had been put asunder by the Civil War was reunited as the PCUS and what was known then as the United Presbyterian Church in the United States of America became what we are today, Presbyterian Church, USA. Close parentheses. That's us. That's who we are. But the great ends of the church, which have been around for 110 years now, have not changed. They're the same. And we're going to start with the first one today. Now that I've given you a little background on what they are. And the first one is the proclamation of the gospel for the salvation of humankind. Now, in the original version, it said mankind, but we have updated and made modern language humankind. We could say all people. In fact, when I come to the end of Matthew's gospel, this is what I read. Now, the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain to which Jesus had directed them. And when they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. And Jesus came and said to them, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, to the end of the age." We call that the Great Commission. And the Great Commission is our charge to preach, to proclaim the gospel for the salvation of humankind. Someone asked me once, what is the gospel? The gospel is the good news of Jesus Christ. The good news that Jesus Christ came into the world to rescue sinners. If you turn in your Bible to John, the third chapter, everyone knows John 3:16. People that don't know anything else in the Bible can almost always recite this one verse, John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. For God sent the Son into the world not to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. We are called as Christians, as a church, to proclaim the gospel. Excuse me. And you notice that this does not say these are the great ends of the Presbyterian Church. It's the Constitution of the Presbyterian Church, USA. It's found in the chapter entitled, the section entitled, the Foundations of Presbyterian Polity. But it's in a chapter that says the mission of the church. It doesn't say the great ends of the Presbyterian Church, great ends of the Presbyterian Church, USA, great ends of Westminster Presbyterian Church, the great ends of Palmasola Presbyterian Church. It's the great ends of the church, the Christian church, the church universal, the church visible and invisible. And our first great end is to preach the word, to proclaim the gospel for the salvation of humankind. Now, how do we do that? If I ask you where the gospel is proclaimed, you'd probably say, from the pulpit on Sunday morning, when the preacher stands up and reads the scripture from the New Testament and preaches, that's the gospel. That's the proclamation of the gospel. And hopefully he or she is preaching something that will lead to the salvation of humankind, one at a time. We have seen a radical change in the way the Christian church proclaims the gospel in the last 6 months. How many of you have watched one of our video services, the Sanctuary of Paul's Holy Presbyterian? How many? Most of you. We're proclaiming the gospel. The last time I checked the numbers, the number of people who watched that particular week's worship service, which included the proclamation of the gospel, exceeded any number that had been in the sanctuary during my tenure here as transitional presbyter, which began in June of last year. We're reaching people we never reached before, and we're reaching people that hadn't been able to hear our services, to see our services, because they couldn't get out on Sunday. They lived at a distance. And it's not just us. The number of services that are broadcast, either live stream or on Zoom or on Facebook Live, or as we do on YouTube, and on YouTube recorded and YouTube live, boggles the mind. We used to think that to reach a lot of people with the good news of the gospel, you had to rent a big convention center or a football stadium and have a crusade like the Billy Graham Crusades. Now, I've participated in a Billy Graham Evangelistic Association event. Been a number of years ago. One of the last ones they had in Florida, really. And I realized at the time that things were different. Things had changed. And the Billy Graham Evangelistic Association has shifted toward more personal evangelism, more small group evangelism, and less of the mass crusades, festivals, celebrations. There was a time when that was a very effective way of proclaiming the gospel. And frankly, the Billy Graham Crusades that were televised were very effective ways of proclaiming the gospel for the salvation of humankind. Sadly, there have been a number of what I like to refer to as televangelists, not true evangelists, but televangelists, who have co-opted and corrupted televised evangelism. One of them once said famously that it was easier to go on TV and get a million people to give you $1 each than it was to find one person who would give you $1 million. I've watched a number of televised preachers over the years. Some of them are very good. Some of them are proclaiming the gospel for the salvation of humankind. Others are preaching a prosperity gospel or salvation by works. It, to me, is contrary to the teachings of Jesus Christ and the writings of the New Testament authors, particularly the Apostle Paul. The good news of the gospel is this, that Jesus Christ came into the world to rescue sinners. In Jesus Christ, our sins are freely and fully forgiven. You hear me say that from time to time, as an assurance of pardon when we have confessed our sins. That's part of the good news of the gospel for the salvation of humankind. And it is good news. And I'm running out of voice, so I'm going to end for today. God bless you and keep you. Remember, Sunday is a communion Sunday. This coming Sunday, September 6th, is a communion Sunday. Cindy Coleman will be leading communion as a part of the service. Please have your elements at home, your own bread, the fruit of the vine, the cup. Have your own. God bless you and keep you until we meet again, even if that meeting come only in the kingdom of heaven, which surely awaits us through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.